So when I woke up on my kitchen floor this morning, I paused to reflect, as I often do, on the masterpiece that is The Last Jedi. I feel like I've done some good work lately to start important conversations about the storytelling genius that lies deep within this movie. But as my friend said right before he firebombed his neighbor's house, there's always more you can do. So with that in mind, let's begin part two of our journey into the genius of The Last Jedi. Now, it's no secret that Rose Tico is easily the most popular character to come out of The Last Jedi, proving not only that it's possible to be effortlessly stylish while looking like Shrek dressed in a sack of potatoes, but also that in a galaxy far, far away, it really is possible to get your hair cut in a vending machine. Now, I have to admit, I used to think of Rose as a preachy, annoying, contrived little chunk of diversity hire who did nothing except steal much-needed character development and screen time away from Finn, while simultaneously humiliating and diminishing him at every opportunity. But clearly I was wrong to think that way, because I didn't understand the true purpose of Rose Tico. You see, Rose is in fact an undercover mole working for the First Order. I know, it's shocking, right? The genius of this movie's script is that it manages to hide its most insidiously cunning character in plain sight, and only now that I've gotten my brain right was I able to unravel her diabolical scheme. The clues are there right in her first scene, where we see her crying over the destruction of the First Order dreadnought in the opening battle. We quickly find out that she's been busy neutralizing and quietly disposing of Rebel personnel as they try to evacuate their doomed ship. She's an insurance policy, you see, a last line of defense to make sure nobody escapes. She's about to do the same thing to Finn when she discovers that he has insider knowledge about the First Order's hyperspace tracking system. So she throws herself behind a hopeless plan that she knows will achieve absolutely nothing except to keep the rebels busy and waste valuable time, preventing them from coming up with something more sensible. She flies them halfway across the galaxy to Canto Bight and parks their ship right in plain sight, making sure they get captured and arrested by local security forces. But she didn't count on BB-8 being there to help them escape, which forces her to improvise. She goes on a violent rampage across the planet, hoping to draw as much attention to them as possible so they can be recaptured. But once again, her plans are foiled by the giant metal testicle. This scene also serves as a potent piece of symbolism for the struggle of women to overcome the oppressive power of the patriarchy. There are so many layers of hidden meaning to The Last Jedi screenplay, it's what makes this movie so endlessly fascinating. Anyway, you can't keep a good character down for long. Rose gets one last chance to save the day during the Battle of Crait, when she heroically disables Finn's fighter just as it's about to crash into the First Order's battering ram cannon. Rose is badly injured and dazed by the crash, and she temporarily forgets her cover story and confesses the whole thing to Finn.
That's how we're gonna win. Not fighting what we hate. Saving what we love.
The real message here is shockingly clear. Rose has fought to protect the thing she loves, the First Order, so they can destroy the thing she hates, the Rebels. Even George Lucas couldn't have written a more brilliantly poetic scene.
Yeah, it's like poetry, so that they rhyme.
Now, the only character who made a bigger splash than Rose Tico in this movie was Captain Phasma. If you thought she was an integral part of The Force Awakens, then you're really in for a treat here. There's just no limit to what she can do, whether it's surviving being dumped into a trash compactor on a planet that's about to be destroyed with the power of an exploding sun, teleporting all the way across a hangar bay in the middle of a scene, or making extra guns magically appear from her armor. There's no doubt that Phasma's a skilled and versatile soldier. She's also able to set up some of the most awesome lines of dialogue ever spoken in the history of film.
You're a bug in the system.
Let's go, Chrome Dome.
Now, this is all great stuff, but it's her personality and character that I really want to get into here. Who is Captain Phasma beneath the shiny armor? What drives and motivates her? What does she aspire to? And what will she do to get it? I was interested to learn more about this fascinating character, so naturally I took to the internet in search of answers. And who better to provide them than Gwendolyn Christie, the actress who played her? Let's hear what she has to say about Captain Phasma's true personality and motivations.
Well, I mean, I am so overjoyed that there is this character in this film. We relate to her due to her actions and her character. And that, I think, is truly modern. But they have a character in it that I feel is truly progressive.
Thanks, Gwendolyn. Nice work. Now, I've talked previously about the excellent, thoughtful, and respectful characterization of Luke Skywalker in this movie, but let's take a moment to consider this other important scene where Luke's finally managed to get rid of Rey, so he decides to destroy the Jedi Temple on Craggy Island so nobody else will come to disturb his retirement, and then Force Ghost Yoda shows up to help him out. Now, you might be asking questions of this scene, like, how is a Force Ghost able to conjure lightning in the real world? Why would Yoda appear to Luke instead of Obi-Wan Kenobi? Why does Luke need help destroying the temple when he was all set to do it himself anyway? Why does Luke try to rescue the Jedi texts from the flames when he was about to destroy them 10 seconds earlier? Why do trees explode when they burn? How is Yoda able to hit Luke on the head when he doesn't even exist in the real world? Is it possible to draw Rian Johnson's head using just a draftsman compass? But the true answers will always elude you, because you're asking all the wrong questions. The real reason for Luke's actions are rooted in what he stands to gain, or more importantly, what he stands to lose. You see, destroying the Jedi Temple would undermine his position of power on Craggy Island, depriving him of the one thing he wants above all else. Yoda knows he'll never make a sacrifice like that, so he does the only thing he can and intervenes. Broken and defeated by the loss of his milk, Luke realizes there's nothing left to do except kill himself. It's a tragic end for a once great man. Now let's finish up this video by discussing my favourite character in the whole movie, Admiral Holdo. Now it's no secret that Holdo's highly competent command style, excellent understanding of human psychology, and her honest, compassionate nature endeared her to almost everyone. But the thing that's most important to explore is the moral lesson that she teaches us. You see, Poe Dameron starts out this movie as a deeply flawed character. He uses tactical initiative, independent thinking, and creative improvisation to lead his forces into battle, and he's not afraid to press the attack when he senses his enemies are off balance and vulnerable. Naturally, those aren't qualities you'd want in your military leaders, so thank goodness Holdo's on hand to show him the error of his ways. She begins by bravely assuming command of a demoralized rebel crew, and issuing orders for everyone to just keep doing what they're doing and hope that something happens to save them. Let's be honest, who wouldn't be reassured and inspired by a speech like that? The only flaw in her otherwise genius plan, naturally, is Poe. I mean, how was Holdo to know that a maverick leader with a deep emotional attachment to the Resistance and a history of insubordination would go behind her back and try to find another way out? So Poe stages a mutiny and he places Holdo under arrest in an unsecured hangar bay with complete access to the ship and a small handful of guards watching over her. Now you might think it would be impossible to escape from such a predicament, but Holdo shows her true mettle and regains command of the ship. That's when we find out that she had an escape plan all along, but she just didn't tell anyone. Now you might be wondering why she didn't tell anyone, when it would have reassured the crew there was a way out of danger provided they stuck together, guaranteed Poe's loyalty and support, removed the need for a dangerous alternative escape plan that wasted precious time and resources, and ultimately allowed the majority of the Resistance to make it safely down to the surface of Krait undetected. But those questions are far less important than the lessons that viewers can carry forward into their own lives. Like, you should always blindly trust authority figures and follow their orders without ever questioning whether it's the right thing to do, even if it makes no sense to you as an individual. It's a tried and tested approach that's always worked well throughout human history, and it's good to see Star Wars reminding us again here. So you see, The Last Jedi really is a gift that keeps on giving for all of us. It's a movie with vast hidden depths that we've only just begun to explore, and I'm excited to be able to share my passion with the fine people of YouTube. In fact, I confidently predict that future generations will look back on this as a film that changed the Star Wars franchise forever. Anyway, that's all I have for today. Go away now.